This meeting will come to order. Good morning. I would like to remind everyone participating through Zoom to mute their microphones when not speaking to help minimize any background noise. If this is your first online meeting or first time using Zoom, please take a moment to locate your mute button. As an additional reminder, per FOIA requirements, board member participation and discussion at this session should remain limited to members of the Finance and Land Use Committee. Board members connected to Zoom that are not members of this committee are encouraged to mute their microphones and turn off their cameras until the session adjourns. Additionally, per electronic meeting requirements, please note that all voting during this meeting will be taken via roll call vote. Per the electronic meeting provisions of the Commonwealth Budget Act, the Finance and Land Use Committee is accepting public comment at this session. Registration for making oral comments was open until noon yesterday through the form on the board or board visitors website. No registrations for oral comment were received. Written public comments that were received will be made part of the permanent record of the meeting. In addition, written comments will be accepted through the same form until the full board meeting adjourns this afternoon. To submit a written comment, please complete the electronic form on the Board of Visitors website under the Meetings and Materials tab at bov.gmu.edu. Are there any corrections to the minutes from the February 25th, 2001 Finance and Land Use Committee meeting? If there are no corrections, may I have a motion to approve the minutes?
So move.
Is there a second?
Second.
The clerk will call the roll.
Vice Rector Blackman?
Yes.
Visitor Itoregi? He is absent. Visitor Moss?
Yes.
Visitor Reagan?
Yes.
Visitor Rice?
Yes.
And Visitor Roth is absent. Thank you.
Motion passes. We have three action items that require votes. To ensure timeliness and assuming there is no objection from the other members of the committee, I will ask for a motion to approve them in block at the conclusion of the presentation. I will now turn the meeting over to Carol Kissel. Thank you.
Thank you, Visitor Reagan, and good morning, everybody. The agenda today will be to present the financial update as we approach our year end, fiscal 21, and also to present the fiscal year 22 budget and financial plan for the board to approve. Deb Dickinson, our Vice President of Finance, will provide a year-end financial forecast, which I will say is very consistent with our prior reporting of performance, and actually has slightly improved. She will take you through some of the details, but in general, our prudent financial management, which includes a refinancing of some debt, COVID relief stimulus funds received from federal and state entities, and our better than projected enrollment in key areas all have worked to buffer our budget for this year and has allowed us to keep our campus operating without severe consequences. Renee, our AVP for strategic budgeting, will then take you through the FY22 recommendations for the budget. And she will seek the committee's action to approve the plan starting July 1. None of the recommendations regarding tuition and fees have changed since our last meeting, although some of the enrollment assumptions may have changed slightly as we gather more information about our fall class and the decisions that students are making. But Renee will spend time talking through that, where we see the campus making some key investments in areas that are consistent with our six-year plan and which focus on our primary mission, which is to support students and faculty successes. As a board, I will remind the board as they consider approval of the budget for this session, I want to remind the visitors that once we have more firm data regarding enrollment, and that happens actually throughout the late spring and summer, and that occurs some changes in the fall, we will come back to the board in October to make any amendments to the budget, which will reflect those changes. We will also consider and include any adjustments that we need to make as a result of the year-end carry forwards. So, and finally, the last part of the agenda, I will take the board through a recommendation of a two-year capital plan, which is a requirement by the Commonwealth and is an action item for the board. The two-year plan will be submitted to the biennium of the Commonwealth in July 1, and more on that later. So with that, I'm going to pass it over to Deb Dickinson to talk about the year-end forecast. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. And if I can pull up the financial slides, I don't see them yet. There we go. That's exactly where I needed to be. As Carol mentioned in her great lead-in, our third quarter forecast is reflecting positive news, and our year-end projection has improved slightly, reflecting an $8 million surplus. And that's before the consideration for the supplemental relief revenue and the debt relief. The highlights of the 3Q forecast you have in the notes at right and in your package. I'm going to highlight some additional items or expand upon them. We had higher than forecasted relief funding of $5 million, which was driven by the acceleration of the HEAR 2 student aid awards. Initially, we had planned to use the HEAR 2 in the spring and fall of 2021, but upon learning of the HEAR 3 American Relief Plan, American Rescue Plan, we decided to accelerate the HEAR 2 awards and extend it to students who had not previously received an award, which resulted in 4,903 students, each receiving $1,000. So that brings the total HEAR 2 awards to approximately 9,800 students and 10.3 million. So that was a great relief to our students. We've, as Carol mentioned, we've had strong financial management through the last few months and heading into fiscal 22. So we had savings on many of the expense categories through that strong financial management. As mentioned in the February board meeting, at the bottom of the financial statement, we had added in the second quarter, we had added supplemental relief revenue. We've also now added the debt restructuring relief and because of the significance. So that is 9 million of the 42 million, and I'll go over that in the next slide. As you recall from February, though, we did have a debt restructuring, and at that time, it's going to be for FY22 and FY23. So the one that you saw in February is for next year and the year following, whereas the 9C impacted FY21 and is reflected in the forecast. The anticipated funding from HEAR 3 is not reflected, as we anticipate receiving that in fiscal 22, and those funds are expected to be 63.5 million. With 32 million of that earmarked for student aid. We are also continuing to monitor additional relief funding that may be available to Mason. And as an example of that, of the additional funding, we've been pursuing with FEMA vaccine clinic operations reimbursement and already have been approved for an additional 600,000. And also we are anticipating receiving reimbursement for extraordinary costs for the safe return to campus activities, such as testing and cleaning disinfection subsequent to January 21st of 21. And we anticipate receiving those reimbursements in fiscal 22. Next slide, please. As Carol mentioned as well, we have the 9C bond restructuring, and this is for the housing projects. So these bonds are used for those projects. And interest rates were lower than we had anticipated when we started reviewing this a few months ago. So our DIS savings are lower than we had initially projected. The 9C restructuring will provide significant relief. It resulted this year in housing not having to draw on their reserves. And this will also provide them relief in FY22. And now Renee Stewart O'Neill, Associate Vice President for Strategic Budgeting and Planning, will provide the budget presentation, and we will be happy to answer any questions after the financial presentation.
Thank you, Deb. Good morning, everyone. I will be giving an overview of the major revenue and expense drivers and key assumptions for the fiscal year 22 operating budget. Next slide, please. Next slide. All right. I'd like to start with an update to the Commonwealth and federal stimulus funding that Mason will receive. In terms of financial aid, The state allocated an increase of $7 million for in-state undergraduate aid. And as Deb just talked about, Mason will be receiving approximately $63.5 million in federal HERF 3 funding, about half of which, or $32 million, will be going for directly to students in terms of aid. For our compensation increase, Mason will be allocating the state authorized 5% salary increase to instructional and research faculty, administrative professional faculty, and classified staff. We'll also raise the adjunct faculty, graduate research assistants, graduate teaching assistants, and non-student and student wage pay scales by 5%. We're very appreciative of the 5% increase that the state has authorized because it will give us an opportunity to address some long-standing market and compression issues that we've identified. In terms of our operating fund, Mason will be allocated an additional $31 million in state base funding in the biennium budget. This represents a 20% increase over our fiscal year 20 general fund state appropriation. This is a strong indication of the state's confidence in our financial stewardship and what we hope will be the first down payment towards the historic funding disparity that Mason has had in comparison to its Virginia doctoral peers. We're receiving one-time COVID funding of $7.5 million from the state to reimburse us for the costs of COVID testing and related COVID escalations in terms of campus operations and service delivery. We are also going to use about half of that $63.5 million in federal HERF 3 fundings to offset the cost of increased operations due to COVID. And finally, the state has allocated $30 million in the capital outlay funds for an additional floor on the life sciences and engineering building on the SciTech campus. Next slide, please. Our fiscal year 22 strategic investment frameworks have they've been prioritized into the five major categories you see below: strengthening faculty and staff compensation, diversity, equity, and inclusive excellence, basic infrastructure support, student success and well-being, and research. We believe that these prioritized funding areas represent our institutional values and opportunities for restoring, reinventing, and repositioning the university. Next slide, please. These next two slides provide examples of specific fiscal year 22 budget requests in the five prioritized categories mentioned in the last slide. Since February, the Ways and Means Committee has been holding budget hearings with academic, administrative, and auxiliary enterprise units where they present their unit goals and articulate how their budget requests align with institutional strategic priorities. No final budget allocation decisions have yet been made. The Ways and Means Committee will be making recommendations to President Washington and senior leadership in June once all the budget hearings have concluded. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. The fiscal year 22 tuition recommendations reflects the fact that we recognize that our students and their families continue to experience significant budget challenges given the pandemic and the resulting economic recession. The proposed tuition increases that you see on this page have been shared with the Board of Visitors in February and April to provide ample time for feedback and discussion. We now present the final unchanged recommendations, which have been incorporated into the fiscal year 22 proposed budget. The tuition rate proposal keeps undergraduate tuition flat and recommends a modest $441 increase to graduate and law tuition rates. In terms of undergraduates, this year, we've seen significant headwinds in our undergraduate yield for both in-state and out-of-state students. And we've also experienced an overall decline in our undergraduate retention. The increase in state general fund appropriations and the increase in state financial aid for in-state undergraduate students will help support the overall undergraduate experience. In terms of our graduate enrollment, there's been a notable increase in student demand for our graduate program offerings. The modest increase of $441 will go towards supporting additional graduate assistantships, an increase in the average amount of the graduate assistantship stipend and an increase in the number of postdoctoral fellowships, which is an important accelerator for research. Next slide, please.
Excuse me.
Yes.
I have a question. Would you rather wait till the end of your proposal and then take questions or do it now?
I think we had said that we would like to wait until the end.
Fair enough. I'm sorry. I missed that. Okay.
No, that's okay. That's okay.
Thank you.
That's fine. In terms of academic targets, we continually assess and seek to improve student academic success outcomes. And this slide gives you several metrics that we use to determine student academic success. I'll just highlight a few. We want to eliminate the achievement gap and maintain equal graduation rates for undergraduate students, regardless of racial, socioeconomic background and income and credentials. Our six-year undergraduate graduation rate in fiscal year 19 stood at 70%. We'd like to increase that undergraduate six-year graduation rate to 75%. And we'd like to increase our freshman to sophomore retention rate from its current rate of about 87% to 90%. So these are just some of the examples of the academic targets we continually monitor and seek to improve. Next slide, please. This next slide just shows the details of the proposed fiscal year 22 tuition rate recommendations for different students by domicile and level. Next slide, please. I'd now like to turn to the mandatory student fee rate recommendation. We're proposing a mandatory student fee increase of 3%. This proposed increase would mean a full-time undergraduate student would have a mandatory student fee of $3,609, which works out to $150.25 per credit hour for our part-time students, or about a $4 increase in the per credit hour rate over the fiscal year 21 rate. We've had a number of questions about how the mandatory student fee is allocated, and there is a difference in the methodology between how we allocate mandatory student fee for undergraduates and graduate students that I'd like to describe. We charge $150.25 per credit hour per semester for up to 12 credit hours for undergraduate students. Full-time undergraduate students, which are those students taking between 12 and 15 credit hours, are charged $1,804.50 per semester. So credits 13 to 15 have no additional mandatory student fee charge. Over 15 credit hours gets charged the $150.25 for each additional hour. For graduate students, the graduate students are charged the per credit hour rate times the number of credit hours taken. There is no credit window or plateau as there are for undergraduate students. The proposed 3% increase would provide an additional $3.3 million in student fee revenues that would be used to strengthen technology investments to support student-focused service delivery, increase career readiness with expanded student employment opportunities, and provide increased direct student services focused on mental health and well-being. Next slide, please. We've shared these planning assumptions with you in December. And these represent our multi-year revenue and expense assumptions that we're using for our budget scenario planning. We have a budget scenario planning tool that's adaptable and flexible and allows us to continually refine different variables that you see here, such as enrollment, tuition, room and board, aid, state appropriations, salary increases, and other major variables so that we can model different financial futures and outcomes and adjust them accordingly as we undertake different planning exercises. Next slide, please. This next slide in the enrollment chart represents a 3% growth rate over our third quarter enrollment forecast, and it's consistent with the FTE equivalency of an annual increase of about 1,000 student headcounts. The Enrollment Management Office, the Budget Office, and the Office of Institutional Effectiveness and Planning, in partnership with the schools, have been working to further develop an enrollment model to refine our strategic growth assumptions on a more detailed programmatic level. We'll be coming back to you in the next few meetings to describe this model and the progress we've made. Next slide, please. Now we are turning to the proposed operating budget. The fiscal year 22 proposed budget reflects revenue and expense plans for the 21-22 fiscal year, including recommended tuition increases, the mandatory student fee increase, and the room and board rate increase. This budget is presented as an all funds budget, which includes all university funding sources, including the educational and general fund, auxiliary enterprises, sponsored programs, contracts and grants, financial aid, capital outlay, and indirect funds. The proposed budget represents a 10.4% increase in expenses over the third quarter forecast from $1.14 billion to $1.25 billion in fiscal year 22, driven primarily by increased investment in state support, federal stimulus funding, the state authorized salary increase in our institutional commitment to competitive compensation, the increase in our institutional commitment to financial aid, and the recovery plan for auxiliary enterprises, which is predicated on a resumption of on-campus activities for the new academic year. The proposed budget also incorporates our ongoing COVID-19 mitigation and safe return to campus plan, strategic investment initiatives, and planned academic and research program expansion. We've learned a great deal during this pandemic year, the importance of having unrestricted institutional reserves on call if needed to mitigate budget shortfalls, the need for enhanced precision of financial projections and regular forecasting, and flexible budget planning scenario tools. The revised fiscal year October budget, as you see here, anticipated the need for us to draw upon $38 million in institutional reserves. As Carol and Deb have mentioned, through careful financial stewardship, improved enrollments, lower spending due to us being primarily remote, and an influx of federal and state stimulus monies, we project to end fiscal year 21 with a net contribution to reserves of approximately $8 million. For fiscal year 22, the $1.25 billion budget is balanced and includes the impact of both supplemental relief funding and the debt restructuring that Deb mentioned. The approximately $91 million in supplemental debt relief and debt savings is made up of the aforementioned $63.5 million in federal HERF 3 funding, the one-time $7.5 million for COVID-related reimbursement from the state, and debt restructuring savings of about $20 million. Next slide, please. We're proposing a blended room and board rate increase of 4.5%. or $540. Broken down into detail, this proposed room and board increase reflects a 5% increase in housing, which is for the price of a traditional freshman double, and a 3.7% increase in the dining plan, which represents the independence meal dining. Next slide, please. In terms of next steps, we're here today in the red box, presenting our all funds fiscal year 20 to budget for approval, tuition and fee, and room and board and mandatory student fee recommendations. In terms of next steps, we'll be presenting an updated five-year financial framework at the July Planning Conference. And at the July Board of Visitors meeting, we'll provide an update on the campus master planning process and the new capital planning and strategy framework, as well as a new version of the fiscal year 22 budget book. Longer term, we plan to give ongoing updates on major transformative operating initiatives, such as performance management and workforce planning, new budget processes, and research investments and infrastructure processes. Next slide, please. Finally, we'd like to recommend approval of the fiscal year 22 proposed operating budget, fiscal year 22 room and board rates, and the proposed fiscal year 22 tuition and fee rates. Thank you, and now I'd like to open it up for questions.
Are there any questions? Jimmy, did you have a question? Or?
Yes, I did. Thank you, Paul. Renee, back at the beginning of your presentation, you mentioned the state and federal monies that came in for student financial aid. Is that, and I'm asking the question because we are looking at the graduate tuition increase, is that additional financial aid money, is that accessible by undergrad and graduate students?
Yes. Yes.
So that could be a source then to help if we do pass the motion. That would help the graduate students that need some assistance on that.
Yes, the financial aid that I referenced in terms of federal stimulus money, that where we're going to receive at least $63 million from the federal HERF funding, and it is mandated that we allocate at least half of that towards overall direct aid to students. And there are no prohibitions, and though Deb and Birch can confirm as to whether or not that must go to undergraduate versus graduate students. We also do, as I said, some of that $441 increase in the graduate student tuition will directly benefit graduate students because we are going to be using some of that to increase the amount of graduate stipends on average by about $800 for a full-time 9-month stipend for a graduate assistantship. We're also increasing the absolute number of graduate assistantships, as well as overall support for graduate students. So a lot of this increase is going to directly support graduate students.
Thank you, appreciate that.
I had a question. On the financial aid, how do you administer that? I mean, does a student have to come in and sort of plead hardship, or is a student categorically eligible if they're, say, a Pell Grant student or they're on some other kind of financial aid? You just assume they have a need, or how does that work?
We have an application process, mm-hmm. and they demonstrate the need, and then the Pell students are already, yeah.
Got it.
Yes.
Okay.
Right. And Birch is on the call. I don't know if you want to add to that.
Briefly, there are two ways the student can qualify. The first is they are identified as a result of their submitted free application for federal student aid in a process that we call a proactive award. And as part of that process, and consistent with the federal guidelines, we do ask for the student to certify that they were negatively affected by the conditions of the pandemic. Again, that is a requirement given to us. The other way is we've administered a large chunk of money through the existing Stay Mason process. So students who are not identified through their submission of free application by federal student aid, think international students, undocumented, that type of thing, those students can go through the Stay Mason process for a more thorough consideration.
Any other questions? Yep. Carol, you want to move on?
Paul?
I think.
Yeah.
First, I'd like to thank Renee for a really excellent report, both in the content and also the presentation. On slide 7, way back, you mentioned the 5% increase for state employees that was coming out of the legislature and the 5% increase for wage employees. How much of that money is actually coming from the state to us versus just they told us to spend it and now it's up to us to find it?
Can you please go back to slide 7 because we have that amount on the slide? The state cost share for this, the 5% salary increase, is going to be about $9.5 million for salary. Now, what will that actually cost Mason? You know, that 5% increase, all costs in, is about $28 million, right? So the state is giving us about $9.5 million for that.
So we're roughly, very roughly, a third.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions before we move on to Carol? Okay, Carol.
Okay, thank you. And thank you, Renee and Deb. If we can go to slide, I think it's 26. I only have a couple of slides here. It's titled the 2-year capital plan. If we can bring those up. Great. So the next slide. So the Commonwealth requires that institutions submit a 2-year capital plan by July 1. In the past, at this meeting, during this time frame, we would provide a 6-year plan that would list all the capital projects related to E&G, where we would require general funds. So given our progression into a tier 3 status, the fact that we are in the stages of completing our phase two of our master plan. We've decided this year to just provide a shorter list of capital projects for review and approval for the board. And we will return this fall after completion of all that work, master plan work, with a more extensive list that will include not just E&G or academic buildings and assets and capital projects, but will also include auxiliary and P3 partnerships. So for now, you'll see today some of the, there's a little bit of a new format, and I'll walk you through it here in these next two slides. That also does include a little bit of information on a capital financing plan for each one of those projects. So table one, as you see here, these represent projects with phased capital budget requests based on strategic priorities. And these projects, we have a clear path forward with the Commonwealth. So the first one there is a telecom phase three. This project was originally submitted as a phase two last year, but the state only funded a third of it in 21. So we're resubmitting this particular request to achieve some of the outstanding funding levels that are due. So the project is an infrastructure project. It's cable, it's replacing cable, wiring, structure. Phase one and two was focused primarily on the outside plant of all three of our campuses. Phase three now is focused more on the internal buildings itself in terms of wire replacement. One of the key significant areas in this particular project is the fact that we are upgrading racks and equipment that will actually provide and enable Wi-Fi access to the outdoor spaces on our campus, right? So this is going to be a big benefit to a lot of students as we re-envision our campus and our new Horizon building has created a larger center of campus where students can conduct work and be inside and outside. The Wi-Fi capability is going to be very strategic for that. On the engineering and science sector study, the second project that you see there, the master plan analysis has allowed us to modify our life sciences and engineering building, which is actually going to be built on the SciTech campus. And this particular study is going to really look at some of the decisions that we made in the life sciences and engineering building, which actually pivoted the use of that building to be more graduate programs, lab space, hybrid instructional delivery, and developing community partnerships. So because we pivoted with the use of the building for the life sciences and engineering building, this sector study actually will allow us to focus on the impact of that decision on the Fairfax campus. And this particular study will address our current and future needs that we have for engineering, computing, and science, specifically lab space, which we are desperately in need of on our Fairfax campus. So that's that particular project. And actually, I will mention that in that sector study, it will certainly include phases of replacing or demolishing David King Hall and Planetary Halls, which are actually two of our buildings that have the lowest facility condition index. And that's coming as a result of our master plan work. So additionally, the LSEB is not quite the space designed to support student capstone projects. So the Life Sciences Engineering building, as we reimagine it, was we were looking to put capstone project work for students that have capability to do student innovation. So we decided to pull that out of the LSEB building and actually have a separate student innovation factory on our Fairfax campus. This kind of factory, we're calling it, is really a low cost dollar square footage to build. It's probably pre-engineered. It looks very similar to the facilities building that we have on our campus currently, the facilities complex that you see there. And it will be designed for students and for student projects for their capstone coursework. Engineers like concrete canoes, robotics, and the like will be done in there. So that's what the Student Innovation Factory project is. And the last thing I will mention is, as a result of the master plan work, the decisions made about the Life Sciences Engineering building to support graduate programs will need to expand capacity for our undergraduates in science and engineering on our Fairfax campus. As I mentioned, we are in desperate need of lab space for our students. So therefore, it's being proposed that a new engineering and science building, which we're calling phase two implementation, is we're looking to promote that building as a consideration for ongoing. And it will be a traditional academic building with interdisciplinary instruction. The master plan has identified the severe lack of working lab spaces, so which is why we're actually including this new building on the plan. And then lastly, actually, we have Academic 8, which you've heard of before. We have planning funds that have already been authorized by the Commonwealth and approved by the state, and we expect to implement a budget request for Academic 8 next year as we get more information on our master plan. And then one thing I'll mention before we leave this slide, on the right in green, you see where we actually are starting to develop a more robust transparency with respect to capital financing plans. Most of the projects issued here are general fund requests, although there are some with operating reserves and others. We have committed debt and philanthropy and the like. So if you go to slide two, this is new. It reflects really our strategic, this reflects the strategic priorities, the projects that really don't have a clear path forward based on funding and scope, as well as they are inclusive of auxiliary projects, which we are actually bringing forward now to the board in a more comprehensive way. So these are projects with funding thresholds that are not necessarily met. And as you can see here, business point of view, Center for the Arts, and also projects that require additional scope, definition, and funding. And again, that will be forthcoming as we close out our phase two of our master plan. We do have the recreation addition connection here to sub one and a possible renovation in order to support those buildings, which definitely need renovation and addition. And that's on the well-being phase of our capital program. And of course, then we have the Eagle Bank Arena, which is 40 years old, I think, as talking to someone the other day, and it is in need of a renovation and possibly an addition. When you see the Eagle Bank Arena addition part, you see on the right-hand side where we're actually indicating that we might be able to get general funds for that. And the reason is because we may, in the addition, be able to scope a program that it's very student dominated and student support and student related. And if we can do that, we can designate that addition as part of an ENG building. So again, this is table two is not what we will submit to the Commonwealth because it's mostly auxiliary buildings with the exception of the business school, of course. But we will submit the table one based upon the approval of the Board of Visitors. So I have one other item, Visitor Reagan, and I can quickly go through it and then we can take any questions. Great. So on the next slide, this is really just a, next slide, thank you. This is actually an easement request, Washington Gas, by the way, the Peterson Companies has requested a 5 foot by 15 foot easement to attach the main gas line that's running adjacent to Robert Rhodes, which is where they're doing their development. And the easement will allow for that connection of the housing development and the existing gas infrastructures. We are recommending the board approve this. Well, we are not recommending to do an appraisal. I believe the appraisal work that we would do would actually cost more than the value of the easement, the 75-foot easement. So we're recommending that the Board of Visitors approve this. And it actually complies with the Commonwealth of Virginia, where we're required to receive remuneration for any value. And of course, the value that we have here is about $2,000. So that's the end of the capital presentation. And I'm happy to take any other questions.
Are there any questions? Okay. Hearing none, thank you for that presentation. That was terrific. Hearing no questions, I move the committee approve the three action items as detailed in the board book. Is there a second?
Second.
Clerk will call the roll.
Vice Rector Blackman? Visitor Itoredi is absent. Visitor Moss?
Yes.
Visitor Reagan?
Yes.
Visitor Rice?
Yes.
Visitor Roth is absent. Vice Rector Blackman? Thank you.
The motion passes. Is there any other business before the committee?
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Just a comment following up on the question that Visitor Rice asked. It's a great question, Ed, and it's something that Dr. Washington and I talk about a lot, because the real challenge, I mean, there's a difference in that 5% language if you say it was authorized versus appropriated, and that's directly what your question went to. But there's still a lot of work to be done to make the 5% work, which I know Dr. Washington and his team and Carol are working hard to make sure we meet that. But it points out the continuing lack of full support from the legislature for what it cost. So I thought your question was good. Thank you.
And I'm not too proud to hold somebody's feet to the fire and say, if you give us enough of these gifts, we're going to go bankrupt. Give us some better gifts.
Great. Well, there being no further business, I declare the meeting adjourned.